The Biden administration banned a sugar company based in the Dominican Republic from exporting sugar to the United States. Welcome to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm Wilkin Brutus. The company with local ties to businessmen in West Palm Beach was penalized for allegedly using forced labor in its operations. A reporter provides insight on what that means for the workers. Also, it's Miami Art Week. Hundreds of art lovers are strolling through international satellite fairs and local exhibitions just in time to celebrate the 20th anniversary of Art Basel, Miami. Finally, a Miami-Dade commissioner is calling out Florida International University's Cuban Research Institute for inviting an author to speak about her new book, Examining Cuban Advantages in the Federal Immigration System. All of that today on a South Florida Roundup after the news. I'm Wilkin Brutus, and welcome to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. The Central Romana Corporation, a sugar company based in the Dominican Republic, was banned from exporting sugar to the United States after the Biden administration said it has information that, quote, reasonably indicates the use of forced labor in its operations. The sugar company is the biggest landowner and employer in the Dominican Republic. Their sugar is sold in the U.S. under the Domino brand. The news comes amid strains in the U.S.-Dominican relations, particularly when it comes to alleged discrimination against Haitians. Just this week, the State Department issued a travel warning for black and dark-skinned Americans traveling to the country, saying they might be racially profiled or arbitrarily detained. Joining us now is Sandy Tolan, a best-selling author, journalist, and professor at USC's Annenberg School of Communication and Journalism. Sandy, thanks for joining us.
Hey, Wilkin, good to be with you. How are you doing?
Hey, all is well. I'm staying hydrated. Thank you. The Central Romana Corporation has long faced allegations of subjecting its workers to poor labor conditions. Sandy, could you give our listeners a little background on this company and these allegations?
Sure. So Central Romana and Casa de Campo together, which is a luxury tourist resort, all within the 240,000 acres of Central Romana, was purchased by the Fanjul family of West Palm Beach in 1984. Central Romana is the biggest landowner, as you mentioned, the biggest employer, huge political influence in the Dominican Republic and the U.S. Just for an example, Wilkin, the former president of Central Romana was also the vice president of the Dominican Republic, its foreign minister, its ambassador to the U.S., and in the U.S., tens of millions of dollars from the Fanjul Corporation and affiliated groups have gone to U.S. politicians. The biggest recipient of the Fanjul and Fanjul Corporation and affiliated groups' largesse is, unsurprisingly, Marco Rubio, Senator Rubio. But they've donated to both sides of the aisle. The Clintons have received substantial donations. So its influence in the Dominican Republic, Florida, and Washington is almost beyond measure. And the return on investment has been huge too. By one agricultural economist estimate, tens of millions of dollars just from the guaranteed price supports from the U.S. government, which pays, you know, a lot more than the world marketplace price. But back to your background question, in the early 2000s, there was a Spanish-British Catholic priest named Christopher Hartley who came to the DR and began living amidst the cane workers on the plantation of another company known as the Vicini Group. And he went toe-to-toe with them for years, advocating for his poor parishioners who were cane cutters. Eventually, Hartley was driven out by all manner of death threats under, it was unclear exactly from who, but some years later, working with a former labor and State Department official named Charlotte Ponticelli, he succeeded in getting the Labor Department to begin monitoring visits to the cane fields. And it appears that the Vicini operation really cleaned some things up, but the Labor Department had no enforcement power. And a couple of federal officials told me that the Central Romana, the Fanjul-controlled company, was considered the most resistant company to change. And that's when Reveal and then later Mother Jones had my colleague, Dominican Haitian colleague, Euclides Cordero Noel, and I launch our investigation.
And Sandy, I think that's a great way to sort of segue into that. Again, thanks for talking about the sort of Fanjul and Romana Corporation influences across the political aisle here. So Sandy was part of a 2-year investigation on these allegations with his reporter partner, Euclides Noel Cordero Noel, for Reveal, Mother Jones, and Intercept. Here's a clip from that investigation titled The Bitter Work Behind Sugar.
Central Romana says it's poured millions of dollars into the Bates to improve living and working conditions. We're going to check that out.
We're heading towards a Bate named Cacata, Las Cacata.
Cacata is a place Central Romana calls a model Bate. We walk the quiet streets, laid out in a grid about a mile long in total. At first, we see small houses in tidy rows with dirt yards, families relaxing. The kinds of uplifting images promoted on Central Romana's website. But as we walk deeper into the Bate, we reach a grim-looking line of concrete barracks.
Yes, okay, here we go.
And just beyond, we find two cane cutters sitting on a pair of broken plastic chairs. Euclides greets them warmly in their native Creole, and they invite us to join them. I'm calling the men Julio and Cardenas. They don't want us to use their real names out of fear of retaliation for talking with outsiders. And that's the case with most of the workers we meet in the Bates. Cardenas says on a good day, he can cut about a metric ton of cane. That's 2,200 pounds. And that one ton gets them a little over $3 from Central Romana. The company says it pays more than the national minimum wage, and younger men can cut more and make $5, $6, even $8 a day, but not Julio and Cardenas.
If it's good, you can cut one ton per day.
A lot of the sugar Julio, Cardenas, and their fellow workers cut ends up in the U.S. The men say they've been doing this kind of work for the past 40 years. They're way past retirement age. Cardenas is almost 80. But even though Central Romana deducts government pension funds from their paychecks, they say they've never seen one peso of it.
Now, Sandy, the Central Romana Corporation have issued a statement via Twitter stating that over the last decade, they've invested millions of dollars into improving the working and living conditions of their employees in the Bates. You reported on human trafficking and child labor in the Dominican sugar industry in the 90s. What's changed since your previous investigation in the 90s?
Well, so when I was there 30 years ago with my then reporting partner, Alan Wiseman, it was really shocking, Wilkin. We saw people being put into barracks where they would lock the barracks at night and have guys standing out there with shotguns. They had children working the fields as young as 14 years old or younger even. We met a 14-year-old who had been kidnapped by the Dominican military and dumped into a cane field run by the state sugar council at the time. Actually, when I went back 3 years ago and began working with Euclides, who, by the way, grew up on one of these work camps, one of these Bates, they call them, it was to try to find Lulu Pierre, to find out what happened to him. But instead, we found other things. Now, clearly, the conditions have improved in terms of child labor and in terms of the kind of forced labor that I saw in the 90s. But what the labor department had begun after a Catholic priest got involved, Father Hartley got involved, the labor department had begun doing these monitoring, annual and biannual monitoring trips, but they had no enforcement. And so what's happened is that the notion of forced labor has really changed from just forcing people that they couldn't leave the plantations. The International Labor Organization and their standards are known as indicators, 11 indicators of forced labor, are followed by the customs, U.S. customs, which does have enforcement power. And that's what's changed in terms of U.S. monitoring. U.S. customs in their announcement very recently, which was sparked in part by our reporting, found 5 indicators of forced labor called abuse of vulnerability, isolation, withholding of wages, abusive working and living conditions, and excessive overtime. And especially for us, Euclides and I saw a lot of these really rough working and labor and living conditions. You had people out in the fields with torn torn overalls that were supposed to be protective coveralls for people who were spraying the crops, broken masks, and a lot of people had fallen sick and fallen ill. And there was a number of lawsuits against the Fanhul Corporation in Central Romana.
And but we'll,
also
we'll talk
what we
about
saw
the, I'm sorry,
is,
go ahead.
Is, I'm sorry?
Yeah, yeah, go ahead. My apologies.
Okay. I was we also just saw people living in these really horrific conditions with no electricity or running water. You know, people talked about the inadequate protective gear, as I mentioned, and every single family we spoke to talked about the fact that their services for access to healthcare was extremely limited, and nearly every family talked about this mountain of debt. They're paid so little that they had to borrow on an interest rate of 10% per week. In other words, 500% annually. So the company has said that it's made improvements, and we did see evidence of painted houses. But on the other hand, you know, they appeared to rush to demolish some of the worst batés that had the worst conditions just before the State Department went to have a visit a little over a year ago. So it's possible that this action is going to spur greater reforms, and that's what the company says in English.
And Sandy, English I hate to interrupt,
but in Spanish, they have remained rather defiant in their Spanish statement.
And Sandy, briefly, what did they have to borrow the money for? Living expenses?
Yeah, well, a lot of it's medical expenses. You know, people get sick. I met one guy who was a fumigator, and his brother had fallen ill. He had been a cane cutter. He couldn't go anywhere. He was just lying in bed all day. And so this guy was borrowing money at 500% annual interest rate to just try to get treatment for his brother, because his brother wasn't eligible. A lot of family members told us they're not eligible. There's a state-of-the-art hospital that Central Romana brags about, but almost every cane cutter we asked about it said, well, that's off limits to us. But they do market that state-of-the-art hospital to the tourists at the five-star resort of Casa de Campo.
These are horrendous details regarding the working conditions here. Is it a separate issue from the, quote, forced labor, legally speaking?
Well, it falls. I mean, I'm not claiming to be a forced labor expert. I'm not a lawyer. I don't work in enforcement, obviously. But as a witness to what's happening and knowing what the charges are, abusive working and living conditions, it seems to me that some of the conditions we saw, the working and living conditions, given that that was cited as one of the five indicators of forced labor, I think you could argue that has something to do with it.
Sandy, the Fanhul family, which resides in West Palm Beach, an hour north of here, owns the Florida Crystals Sugar Company. They also own 35% of the Central Romana Corporation. Have you heard from them about the company's working conditions?
Well, the Fanhul family wouldn't talk to us. They are famously secretive. They rarely give interviews. The brothers, Alfonso and Pepe, live, as you said, in West Palm Beach in these seaside mansions. You know, they have a very famous, although they're secretive, they've been written up in the so-called shiny sheet and other, lifestyle publications for their yachts and their, you know, expensive hotel stays. They also host charity balls, doling out millions to charter schools and daycare centers. But they would not talk to us. You know, John McCain once called the family the first family of corporate welfare, the former now late senator. The Fanhul company, the corporation, did release a statement to us a while back when we were doing our reporting, praising Central Romana as a highly respected corporate citizen in the Dominican Republic that, quote, takes pride in its reputation for civic activities and ethical business practices.
And Central Romana put out a statement on their Twitter that says that they are willing to work with Dominican and American authorities to address the issue at hand. Is there any update to what is happening between Central Romana and authorities so far?
Yeah, Wilkin, that's a really good question, and it's a hard one to answer right now. I've been on the phone, every day at some length, and trading many and lengthy WhatsApp messages and other messages with people who are concerned for their own safety, who are trying to get information. One thing that's clear from the people we have been able to reach in the work camps, in the Batés, is they're being told not to talk to outsiders, which could, again, not being a labor expert, official, it could actually, it seems to me, exacerbate one of the five customs indicators of forced labor, which is isolation. But in the meantime, a lot of concerns about possible retaliation, possible threats, very vague at this point. One person wrote to me and said he was recently called an enemy of the state on a kind of, but it wasn't clear from who, some strange calls trying to get other sources to talk, not knowing who those people are. So it's really hard to know exactly. But in the meantime, as you indicated, there are a lot of roundups, mass deportations. Even a report that there might not be enough cane cutters for the harvest, which is about to start. And then you mentioned the travel advisory, which I've never seen anything quite like this, that especially dark-skinned Black Americans would be advised to reconsider a trip to the Dominican Republic because of the possible encounters with immigration officials. I mean, this is pretty alarming.
Yeah, it has certainly affected everyone, even folks in the diaspora. From the perspective of those in the Dominican Republic, how does this ban affect their livelihoods? How much influence does this company have on life in the DR?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, the former president of Central Romana was the vice president of the country and held other posts, including ambassador to the US. So, being the biggest landowner and the biggest employer, they are immensely influential in the DR as well as in the US, as I mentioned, and in Florida, of course. I think that a lot of people are outraged by this. There are many people who are not of Haitian descent who are also shocked by the conditions in the camps, in the work camps, the Batés. And there are a lot of people of conscience who, want to improve it. Central Romana itself says it wants to improve. But I think it was interesting to see the distinction, Wilkin, between the rather conciliatory statement that Central Romana made in English just after the customs issued its ban on imports, and the one it made in Spanish when it said, "We're proud of the work we've done over the last 100 years," and they didn't mention anything about being conciliatory. In fact, they do want to work with the United States officials and get this ban lifted, but I think it's going to take a while.
Yeah, it sounds like there's a lot more work to do. Sandy Tolan, a best-selling author, journalist, and professor of USC's Annenberg School of Communication and Journalism. Sandy, thank you so much for your time and detailed reporting.
Thank you, Wilkin. I just want to give one more shout out to my friend and colleague, Euclides Cordero Newell, grew up on Abate, Haitian descent, Dominican citizen, and without his courage and great humanity, this reporting would not have been possible.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Wilkin.
Still to come, hundreds of art lovers are in town to celebrate Miami Art Week, which marks the 20th anniversary of Art Basel, Miami. 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. I'm Wilkin Brutus. Welcome back to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. It's Miami Art Week. Every year, for 1 week, Miami transforms into the center of all things art, design, music, and culture. And this year, the flagship institution, Art Basel, turns 20. Hundreds of galleries, collectors, and art lovers are strolling through countless international satellite fairs and locally based art exhibitions throughout Miami-Dade. What's missing? The enthusiasm around crypto and NFTs that dominated Art Basel last year. But the conversation surrounding how and why we produce and consume traditional and multimedia art remains strong. Joining us to talk about all things art and culture during Miami Art Week is Miami Herald reporter, art reporter Amanda Rosa and Miami-based multimedia artist Marcus Blake. Amanda and Marcus, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
Amanda, let's start with you. In regards to the atmosphere surrounding Miami Art Week, it seems like enthusiasm surrounding crypto, NFTs that had dominated Art Basel last year has calmed down after recent high-profile crypto scandals such as FTX and the steep drop in the NFT market. Is that a fair assessment?
It kind of is. It kind of depends on who you ask. I think in general, there's definitely less NFT-related events happening this year, and all the events that are related to Web3 and crypto have become a little bit more curated as opposed to this huge explosion that we've seen previously. In terms of when you go to traditional art fairs like Art Basel, Miami Beach, and the Convention Center, when I went, I frankly didn't see that many NFTs on display at all. It's mainly just traditional, physical, actual artwork. But in terms of artists who are big in the NFT space, they're still very excited about what the technology can do for their careers.
And Marcus, you're a multimedia artist. You're here in the studio with us. Thanks for joining us. Were you or are you invested in NFT crypto environment as an artist?
I did get into it. I have a couple pieces still on OpenSea, and moving into it, I thought about, you know, the whole digital aspect of art, and it's something to, you know, at least look into as an artist, just to see where it can take you or take art in general. But I have a couple pieces in it.
And what are your assessment to Amanda's perspective in terms of, like, you know, the atmosphere sort of waned a little bit this year? Have you noticed that?
I have some friends that are involved in the NFT world, and she's been pretty busy every day since Art Basel has started. So that world is still operating out there, the NFT. They're still pushing it. But it does exist.
So this feels sort of like a minor setback. It's the movement is still strong,
yes,
but perhaps this year is just a minor setback.
Definitely a setback in the NFT world just because of the fluctuation. But they still believe and they're still pushing it.
Do you still believe as an artist?
I'm a physical artist. You know, I really like being in the physical space, and not saying I'm against the NFT, but I like physical work. I like to work with my hands and being in the third dimension.
Wow. And Amanda, early stages of the pandemic certainly made attending in-person art events difficult for many people. How would you describe the atmosphere at the Miami Convention Center? Did the gathering feel like a return back to normal during abnormal times?
Oh, yeah, definitely. A lot of people were very excited and happy to be back in person. In previous years, I believe last year, fewer galleries were able to participate in Art Basel, Miami Beach in general, either because they couldn't travel internationally or they were like on hard times financially. And this year, Mark Spiegler, who was the global director of Art Basel, said that this year in Miami Beach is the largest edition we've ever had, because of the sheer number of galleries who are participating. And when I went the other day, it was frankly kind of overwhelming. I got lost several times. It's a lot of people who are very excited, a lot of art collectors who are very busy buying art for millions and millions of dollars, and galleries who are very happy with the turnout.
And so economically, it's so far a successful event to your estimation.
Definitely.
And how would you describe the overall mood or theme evoked by the artists this year? Was it dark? Was it light? Was it a mixture of both?
It's definitely a mixture of both. A lot of the artwork that really stood out deals with themes of either climate or identity. There was one artwork in particular. I forget the artist's name off the top of my head, but if you go to the Meridian section of Art Basel, you'll see it. You can't miss it. It's this huge installation that's entirely bedazzled. It's like those telephone poles with the wires, and there's bedazzled sneakers with flowers coming out of them. And that artwork is reflective of just the year 2020 and how many lives were lost, both in terms of racial injustice and also the pandemic itself. So artists are definitely reflecting on the darker themes of the last year, but there's a hopeful undertone.
And I'll pose the same question to you, Marcus. How would you describe your overall mood as an artist in 2022?
I'm still hopeful. You know, like I said in the beginning, I'm a colorful person. I look forward to, you know, making things bright and extravagant. I don't know. I think 2022.
I guess what inspires you as an artist? Like when I see your work on these buildings, it's intricate. It's colorful. There's all sorts of different, it seems like, influences in your work. And so what has inspired you in 2022 as an artist?
I feel like I'm like an antenna. I'm just absorbing the environment and I process it. It's really hard to say, like, as an artist, I look at myself as a creator. So I'm really just absorbing and processing the world around me. It's not saying that I need to create anything in particular. As I absorb my environment, I then, you know, regurgitate it into the streets, being colorful because of the, I don't know, that's just the grittiness of the streets sometimes. And being in that space, it's, you need to see the world for what it is or how you would like to see it. So just being more expressive, and I don't know, if I could, I would paint my whole entire neighborhood.
Yeah. I see the geometric shapes on buildings, and I'm sure it's quite the experience to do that as an artist. But as a viewer, as a consumer of art, it's very interesting to know what went through the thought process, the sort of flow state in the artist's mind when they're creating these geometric patterns.
You know, I think I'm just truly in the moment. There is no precursor of how to get it done. It's really like nature. You can plant a seed and the tree will do what it needs to do. And it's the same. I can show up on a sidewalk and I'm instantly inspired to do it. You know, I could start with one line and then from that line, just keep expanding in the pattern. But I'm not really trying to think about where things need to go. It's just, I'm going to do it because right. I'm in the moment. And that's really my formula.
That's always hard to describe to someone who isn't creating your art, how it's processed, but you know, you're in the flow state. Amanda, of course, Art Basel celebrates established artists such as Jeff Koons, Pablo Picasso, etc. Were there any new emerging and mid-career artists that stood out for you?
Yes, and at several art fairs. Someone who stood out to me a lot at Art Basel in particular is an artist from Ghana. I believe his name is pronounced Amoako Bowafa. His portraits, which are really beautiful, I saw them all over the place. At Scope in particular, which is also on Miami Beach, there is a digital artist from Nigeria who goes by the name Osinachi. And he's really interesting. His work is sold on the blockchain as NFTs because it's digital, and he makes his artwork out of like Microsoft Word. There's Cornelius Tella, who has an event in Wynwood. He's working with an Everglades organization, and he's bringing the Everglades to Miami. And there is another Miami-based artist named Mark Floridor, who has a really amazing show called Sunshine at Young Arts.
I'm Wilkin Brutus. This is the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. I'm speaking with Miami Herald's art reporter Amanda Rosa and Miami-based multimedia artist Marcus Blake. 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. You can also tweet us at WLRN. Now, the Hampton Art Lovers and Point Comfort Art Fair in Overtown has an art exhibition and conversation series at the historic Ward Rooming House, and they're celebrating the remnants of lost African traditions through Black artwork collected by Hampton University Museum and Florida Memorial University, and it features Florida artists such as Tiffany Glenn. Amanda, what were some of the satellite fairs that really stood out for you outside of the more popular places such as the Design District, Miami Beach? Were there any popular spots that are sort of in the outskirts of those popular areas?
I haven't been everywhere yet, so I'm excited to go to the places that I'm about to mention. I'm definitely going to check out Point Comfort in Overtown. There is another art event that's dedicated to Black art in Opa-locka called Art of Transformation. In the design district, it's not a fair, but it is like an independent, smaller arts group. They put on a show called Boil, Toil, and Trouble. There's a New York-based artist named Nereida Patricia. She made a whole fountain like that's inspired by primordial waters. So I'm definitely going to check that out. And also, our local museums are having really cool shows that are going to stay on, well after Miami Art Week ends. Didier Williams, who is originally from Miami, has a show at the Museum of Contemporary Art in North Miami.
Yeah, very fascinating. There's also places in Opa-locka, like you said, Overtown. I know Mikel Solomon's Prism Art Fair is also in the Design District. So many different satellite fairs that are occurring outside of the main Miami Convention Center. I do have a question in regards to trends. Years ago, glass art was huge. Video art in more recent times. Are there significant trends you're seeing this year, Amanda? And I can pose the same question with you, Marcus, after Amanda.
Oh, that's a good question. I think artists are getting very creative in terms of digital art, which is always exciting because usually when people think of like digital art or NFTs now, you may think of, the kind of infamous Bored Ape Yacht Club gorilla things. But I'm seeing some really cool and insightful artwork in the digital space. I'm also noticing just a lot of sparkly and shiny things. Which I don't know, maybe I just noticed that because it looks pretty to me, but I'm definitely noticing the brighter things.
Yeah, I know artist Reginald O'Neill in Overtown has a QR coded mural on the International Longshoremen Association building in Overtown. And essentially, you can scan that QR code and then read and take in the contributions of the black longshoremen in Overtown. Marcus, you describe your artwork as tapenology, from what I've read. So we're talking about trends, but are you for trends or are you for bucking trends?
It's actually called tapenology.
Tapenology.
Yeah, because I work with a lot with tape, 3M tape, different sizes, and the work looks really technical. But to I don't know, re repeat that one
Yeah,
more
yeah.
time.
We were talking about certain trends that Amanda.
Yeah,
Yep.
so trend-wise, I'm not really, I wouldn't say I follow any trends. And my thing is to really to push my mind as far as I can push it to come up with, something new. It might not be anything new under the sun, but it feels good to try, And, the streets right now, I would say there's a lot of maybe, I won't say political, but more moving away from like traditional canvas work to more three-dimensional objects, the NFTs, just I think pushing the boundaries of imagination, creativity to see what else can be done outside of a
So,
canvas.
when I think of tape, I think of something that's tangible. Are you using the tape as a sculpture material?
The tape is, I tape it and then I, remove the tape and then it leaves a negative space. So, but yeah, 3M tape, masking tape, different size of tape. That it's not really about the tape. The tape is just used as what it's for, is to mask it. And then as you color over it and remove it, it makes a negative space.
And did you always set out to be an artist? Obviously, folks ask artists all the time, how did you create this work? What's the meaning behind your work? But what's the meaning behind your journey as an artist? Was this something you've always wanted to do?
See, I have, yeah, like this. I have this conversation about being an artist often, and I still can't consider myself an artist. I really think I'm just a very creative person. An artist, I think, is someone who's like has a practice of one particular thing they're trying to master. I'm trying to just master being as creative as possible. Not to say that, the tape work, if I only did tape work, I feel like that would be my art. But, my art is my life of being creative and, manifesting realities and morphing reality in front of me, by through the canvas work or taking the work to the street to then change people's perspective, turning something gray and dark into something, you know, bright. So there's no, I don't know, that definition is really tricky with me being an artist.
You know? Right. And Amanda, I'll pose the same question to you. Obviously, you're the art reporter, but you clearly have the eyes for art. Would you consider yourself an artist as well, or are you more comfortable just reporting on it? What's your take?
Oh yeah, I was an artist before I was a writer. When I was younger, I was very big into drawing and painting. My parents put me in like every single art class you could think of in the South Florida area. And I didn't get into journalism and writing until I was in high school because I realized I was actually very good at it. So that's why I stuck to it. But I consider, honestly, journalism to be an art in a way, because it's an art, not a science. There's so many different ways to go about it and approach it. Writing, even if you're writing about current events, is an art in and of itself. And so, yeah, that's my take.
All right. Amanda Rosa is Miami Herald's art reporter, and Marcus Blake is a Miami-based multimedia artist. Amanda, thank you so much for your time. Marcus, Blake, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Still to come, a Miami-Dade commissioner called out Florida International University's Cuban research over a book examining Cuban privilege in the federal immigration system. 800-743-WLRN, 800-743-9576. I'm Wilkin Brutus. Welcome back to the South Florida Roundup on WLRN. Newly elected Miami-Dade Commissioner Kevin Cabrera, who represents areas such as Coral Gables and Hialeah, is calling out Florida International University's Cuban Research Institute for inviting an author to speak about a new book that examines the advantages that federal immigration law granted Cuban immigrants who came to the United States. Quote, hate-filled, inflammatory, anti-Cuban are words that Cabrera, the son of Cuban immigrants, used to describe Boston University's Professor Susan Eva Exton's new book, Cuban Privilege. Eckstein told WLRN's America's editor Tim Pageant that her book is an academic exploration of how U.S. policy has treated Cuban immigrants as compared to treatment of immigrants from other countries, such as Haiti. He joins us now to discuss this topic. Tim, thank you for joining us.
How you doing, Wilkin?
I'm sorry for butchering her last name there.
Eckstein.
Eckstein. There we go. First, what does the academic book seek to examine? What's the overall premise?
Well, first, I need to say I have not read the book. Which is important here, because we need to note that Commissioner Cabrera is making these accusations without himself having actually read the book. What I know about the book is an excerpt I've read, and plus my conversation this week with Susan Eckstein, who's a sociologist at Boston University, as you pointed out. And the premise of the book is simply to look at the largely Cold War immigration privileges, benefits, advantages, as you called them, that Cuban immigrants got because they were escaping communism, Fidel Castro in Cuba, and the benefits that they did receive, the sort of immigration fast track that they received was a result of this Cold War milieu at that time. And what her book examines, she tells me, is how on the one hand, how Cuban Americans did a very impressive job parlaying those advantages into becoming one of America's most successful immigrant groups politically and economically. But also it examines how other immigrant groups got shortchanged in the process, like Haitians, like Central Americans, and asks, A, was that fair? And B, what can the country do to make amends for that by trying to extend those kinds of privileges to more groups other than just Cubans?
And so she's not coming from an advocacy point of view. She's coming from an academic.
No, she insisted in our conversation that this was not an anti-Cuban book. She was simply examining the dynamic of how those privileges work for one group and how they were sort of not afforded to other groups, and how that dynamic has affected immigration policy and American society in the aftermath.
Based on evidence that's clearly publicly already available.
Exactly. But she insisted, though, that much of her book is largely complementary of Cubans, which is one of the ironies here.
Yeah. Some people in Cabrera's district may not know the policies that help Cubans. Does she mention a specific policy that helped shape Cuban migration to Florida?
Well, I think that the policy that everyone who does research on this issue points to is the 1966 Cuban Adjustment Act, which, as I said before, gave Cubans a sort of a fast track to legal residency once they got here in the United States that, again, that was not afforded to other immigrant groups. And, you know, if you're here for a year, for example, as a Cuban migrant, you are essentially put on that fast track to legal residency and ultimately citizenship here, which is just not the case for any other migrant group in this country.
And if you've read those facts, that fast track was called wet foot, dry foot.
Well, wet foot, dry foot was sort of an addendum to the Cuban Adjustment Act. This was during the sort of Cuban migration crisis in the 90s when, you know, the rafters and when they were coming here. What the U.S. did was come up with this policy that said if a Cuban touches dry land, automatically, you know, gets to stay here. But if they're interdicted at sea, then they're sent back to Cuba.
So before President Obama left office, what did he disregard at that time?
Well, what he essentially did just before he left office in 2017 was get rid of that wet foot, dry foot policy. And ironically, again, he was doing that not just, you know, in isolation. There were actually Cuban-American politicians here, including Ileana Ross Layton and Marco Rubio, who really sort of agreed with getting rid of wet foot, dry foot.
Is she in any way criticizing Cubans for taking advantage of special U.S. immigration and what came out and what came with it, the political and economic success stories in the past 60 years?
Well, no, again, I mean, having not read the book, I can't say this, you know, 100% for sure. All I can, again, refer to is my conversation with her, but she insists that the book, as I mentioned, congratulates Cubans for taking those advantages that they were given and turning them into one of America's most impressive immigrant community success stories. I mean, when you look at the political clout, for example, I mean, you may criticize Cubans for having received those special privileges, but you got to take your hat off to them for becoming, when they did become citizens so quickly, they went out and voted. And I have always taken my hat off to Cubans for that. And, you know, so, and I think her book, at least the way she's explaining it, does, you know, again, give them their props for that.
In your recent commentary, you mentioned the exile orthodoxy. The history behind Cuban special U.S. immigration status isn't new, but why is it difficult for people, even academics, to talk about that particular policy?
Well, because you have to look at, as you aptly put it there, the conservative Cuban exile orthodoxy, as I called it in the commentary. Conservative Cuban exile orthodoxy has always objected to two notions here. The first is that Cubans were somehow allowed to cut the U.S. immigration line, let's say, that they became such a successful immigrant community here because they got special privileges. The conservative exile orthodoxy finds that insulting. The second notion it objects to is that Cubans somehow received immigration privileges they didn't deserve, or that other immigrant groups like Haitians or Central Americans deserved as much as they did. Conservative exiles often find that notion objectionable because it suggests that then they're not the special exile group they believe Cubans are and should be.
And this has been documented extensively in WLRN's new podcast, Detention by Design. Did FIU's Cuban Research Institute respond to Cabrera's criticism at all?
Oh, yes. Jorge Duany, the director of the Cuban Research Institute there at FIU, I think he responded the way, you know, anyone in his shoes should have responded, which was simply to invite Commissioner Cabrera to come to the event and listen to Professor Eckstein's explanation of her book afford her a little bit more of an educated, let's say, appreciation of what she's trying to say in this book, rather than just condemn it and demonize it again without even having read it.
Right. Have that dialogue. Have that open dialogue. In terms of politics, Commissioner Cabrera was endorsed by former President Donald Trump. What does Commissioner Cabrera seek to gain politically by criticizing her?
Well, I think he stands to gain quite a lot politically because of what I was just mentioning here. This conservative Cuban exile orthodoxy permeates a lot of the district that he represents. And so by just sort of peremptorily going after, you know, to attack, you know, this book the way he has, that plays really well in District 6 in Miami-Dade County.
And of course, former President Donald Trump reversed Obama's policies, easing trade and travel restrictions on Cuba. I can't help but notice the irony here as well. Could this be viewed as a blatant attempt to censor book readings?
Of course, I think Commissioner Cabrera would obviously disagree with that. Although whenever a particularly a Cuban American politician does something like this, you have to make that analogy, and you also have to wonder how much does this really start to look similar to, for example, what the Committees for the Defense of the Revolution do back in Cuba. When they try to ferret out anti-communist heresy, for example, it looks a lot alike, and it can get scary in that sense. But I think more than anything else, this is just an attempt by Commissioner Cabrera to score big political points in his district.
This attack on this book, or this criticism on this book, got him on the front page of the news. But it may also bring even more attention. Right. To the book itself.
Oh, no.
Politically, is this a win or a loss for him? And is this a win for her?
I think you can make the case this is a win-win. It's a win for him politically. It's a win for her as an author, because I think what he has done for her, and this happens so often when we see these kinds of attacks and condemnation of books, the book actually really benefits from this kind of attention. And I think she's going to get a lot more people coming out to this book presentation that's scheduled for next Friday at Books and Books in Coral Gables than perhaps would have come out had Commissioner Cabrera not, gone on the attack the way he did. I think yes, she's going to benefit from this, ironically.
Yeah, and I didn't know the book was coming out until this controversy.
So me too.
Do you think protests will happen at that book reading?
I don't know. I don't know. I think it's telling that you haven't seen Commissioner Cabrera sort of respond to the backlash against him, for example, here. I mean, I'm not the only one who's written against what he did this week. Fabiola Santiago over at the Miami Herald had a very strong opinion column herself, sort of condemning his condemnation of the book. So I don't know if we are going to see that fervor bubble up for next Friday's presentation. It'll be interesting to see if we do see demonstrations outside Books and Books.
Very briefly, let's segue into the World Cup game happening today. A little unexpected cross-cultural solidarity between Haitians and Brazilians. Mm-hmm. Brazil is facing Cameroon today at 2 p.m. And some people might be quite surprised to see Haitians sporting Brazil's national colors of green and yellow and cheering just as loud as mm-hmm. Brazilians. You've been covering Latin America for a long time. What do you make of Haiti's love affair with Brazilian soccer?
I think it resembles a love affair that a lot of the rest of the hemisphere, a lot of the rest of Latin America and the Caribbean has with Brazil. Brazil has become, but especially for Haitians, as you point out, has become the proxy team. A Seleção, as the Brazilian team is known. It has become the proxy soccer team for a lot of the hemisphere that doesn't have their own great teams. I mean, you know, Argentina's got a great team, Uruguay, Mexico, et cetera. But when you look at countries like Haiti that don't have, you know, great high-profile soccer teams, even my wife's country, Venezuela, which is a baseball country, they've always been fans of Brazilian soccer. And so that's why you're seeing groups like the Haitians come out for their team, the Brazilians.
And they come on in force for a long time. In 2016 Copa America championship, Brazil defeated Haiti 7-1. Mm-hmm. But that one goal by Haiti was massive for the Caribbean, whose team has always been under finance. And so Brazil has been seen as a sort of default picture of excellence. So that bond is always there.
And also a default picture of what Haitians consider themselves in many ways, the underdogs. One of the hallmarks of the Brazilian soccer team is that it is always represented. It is its most famous players, like Pelé, a black Brazilian, for example, from the favelas, the slums. It has always represented the underdogs. in Brazil. And I think that's another reason why Haitians, you know, tend to, you know, because they consider themselves in many ways the underdogs in this hemisphere often. And I think that's another reason why Brazilian soccer, why they have a bond with that.
A lot of underdog stories happening right now. Korea just beat Portugal. Japan is doing well.
Japan,
this
Cinderella
has been an interesting
story,
World
man.
Cup right now with these Cinderella stories, as you mentioned. Tim Padgett is WLRN's America's editor. Thank you so much for your time. Really
Thanks,
appreciate it.
Thanks, as always, Wilkin.
All right. That would do it for the South Florida Roundup. It's produced by Natu Twe. Our engagement editor is Katie Cohen. Our interim managing editor is Katie Munoz. Jessica Bakeman is the senior editor for news. Matt Sanchez is the digital editor. The vice president of radio and show's technical supervisor is Peter J. Mayers. Richard Ives answers phones. I'm Wilkin Brutus. Thanks for calling and listening. And remember, stay hydrated.
WLRN Public Media.